COVID-19 still lingers to humanity like the smell of durian stuck in the MRT.
Disgusting한 냄새가 나요.
Every time you think you have solved it, it creeps back into society. This bad news, however, has not been bad for everybody. At least I can say that some that have invested in pharma stocks, especially those producing the vaccine, have had a good run. Are these vaccine stocks at the end of their bull run, or can we expect a booster shot to these stocks? Hey investors, welcome to The Market Talk. It is me, Ali, your humble VIA graduate. Today, we will be discussing about some pharma stocks, in particular, looking at GlaxoSmithKline, ticker symbol GSK, which is listed on the New York Stock Exchange, and Sanofi, ticker symbol SAN, listed in Euros in the Euronext Paris Stock Exchange. We want to find out how well these companies have been doing and if there is still some room for growth. We will also be taking stock of the COVID-19 situation around the world and examining just how much more do we need to do in terms of vaccine, and finally answering the question, is there room for more vaccines? In Singapore, we can easily say that the show is far from over. At the time of filming, the month is October 2021 and COVID-19 reported cases have been surging in the thousands for daily count. We just broke the ceiling of 2,000 cases per day. Deaths are also increasing, especially amongst the elderly. A shimmer of hope we have is in the belief that the vaccine will not let COVID-19 eliminate us. So the vaccines that were given out in Singapore are Moderna, Pfizer and Sinovac. What people don't understand is that the vaccine helps your immunity to fight against the virus, but it doesn't help prevent the spread of the virus. In Singapore's case, we can also rest a little easy knowing that 82% of the population has been fully vaccinated. This high rate is what counts, because the vaccines boost our immunity and at best we develop mild symptoms. So, whatever naysayers claim, the vaccines do help, especially if the country wants to come back out of a lockdown and if the world wants to start traveling to each other's countries again. Coming back to our topic of pharma stocks, Singapore has reached saturation levels with vaccination. In fact, other developed countries have as well. According to ourworldindata.com, there are 22 countries that have reached 70% fully vaccinated population rates. Some examples are Denmark, Uruguay, Spain, Ireland, and some others. However, the sad news is that only 45.2% of the world has received one dose, and only 2.3% of people in low-income countries have received at least one dose. I think there are two main problems causing this lack of vaccinations. Firstly, because the supply is limited. There are only a handful of vaccine producers. It is not as common as, say, paracetamol. Secondly, it is also because rich nations have been hoarding the medicines. So, long story short, the COVID-19 race to termination is not yet over, and there is still plenty that we can do. That brings me to GlaxoSmithKline and Sanofi. With so much of the world unvaccinated, it gives room to other players to step in and help countries with their fight against COVID-19. If we look at Pfizer's case, they made $3.5 billion in just 3 months of selling their vaccines in 2021. That amounts to nearly a quarter of its total revenue for the year. And as we saw earlier, that is just 40% of the world receiving one dose. In that regards, we will look at these two companies, even after current players have already started selling their vaccines. We have GlaxoSmithKline, or for short, I'm just going to call it GSK, and Sanofi. GSK is a science-led global healthcare company with a special purpose: to help people do more, feel better, and live longer. They work on everything from shampoos to medicine. Based in the UK, the company has been a pharma world leader since 1715. That's almost 300 years. Sanofi is the same. They are a multifaceted health solutions provider. Sanofi is a French company, but there are many other pharma players that have a stake in the company. Sanofi's reach is also worldwide. The thing to note about both companies is that they do invest heavily in R&D and rely on sales of their pharmaceuticals departments to stay afloat. Also, because of COVID-19, both GSK and Sanofi have issued statements to join forces in creating a vaccine candidate based on their adjuvant technology. Currently, this vaccine candidate is in phase 3 clinical trials. All of this is to help COVAX, which is COVID-19 Vaccines Global Access Committee, to supply 200 million doses of adjuvant recombinant protein-based COVID-19 vaccine. Now, before I continue, here is a caveat I would like to point out, and also a counter to the caveat that I'm pointing out. Firstly, the caveat is that I am no pharma expert. I don't know what it takes to make a vaccine, and I don't know what regulations and procedures a pharma has to go through to make this vaccine a reality. That being said, I do know a few simple facts. These companies have a deep and long history of producing medicine and vaccines. They know how to do it. COVID-19 is still here, and the fight against it will take a few years more. Fighting COVID-19 is an urgent business for the world. From WHO to COVAX to governments, there are many parties that want an immediate end to the threat of this pandemic. So, we do know that GSK and Sanofi are going to get this vaccine made, and they will distribute it out to 50%+ of the world that has not even received a single dose. So, let's put on our value investor hats and evaluate these businesses. I'll start with GSK. For financial year 2020, GSK made £34 billion in turnover, or revenue, from pharmaceuticals, vaccines, and healthcare, of which £23 billion were just from pharmaceuticals and vaccines. Not surprisingly, their respiratory pharmaceuticals saw a growth from £3 billion to £3.7 billion in revenue. Here are the financials in a snapshot. From Morningstar.com, we can see that the forward PE ratio is 12.27. That's nicely below 15, so that's acceptable. However, price to book is 4.62 and price to sales is 2.17. Both figures are above 1 and not so attractive. Now let's look at the rest of the figures. Do take note, these figures are reported in pounds. Revenue coming in has been steadily growing for the past 10 years. Quite a strong showing, I should say. For an old and large company, normally we should see it in a declining stage of growth, but it's doing fine. As we discussed earlier, the source of revenue is also stable, coming in from pharmaceuticals, vaccines, and healthcare products. Gross margins of this company is what really stood out to me. Over 60% consistently over the years. Wow, those are impressive margins. And I can see why people invest in pharma stocks. It just has a strong moat. People need it to survive. Subsequently, we can look at their net incomes, earnings per share, and free cash flows. We can see that it's healthy. This shows me that the company can afford to fund its R&D and supply vaccines before they even collect monies for it. But one red flag I did find in GSK is in their debt levels. For a typical company, I wouldn't want more than 0.5 in the debt-to-equity ratio. However, in GSK's case, the debt-to-equity ratio stands at 1.61. My first reaction was that, okay, maybe the company is leveraging on the low interest prices to stock up on some loans. But the past 10 years have been equally high, if not higher. This is a worrying trend for me. Another place to compare debt is with its free cash flow. Some investors like to say that if the company can pay off the debt with free cash flow over 5 years, then we are still safe. So in essence, if the debt to free cash flow ratio is less than 5, we are still safe. Well, long-term debt is standing at 22.5 billion on the balance sheet and free cash flow is at 3.8 billion, which means that debt to free cash flow ratio is 5.9 times. That's almost 6. That is higher than our ceiling of 5. But some investors may be able to live with it. Depends on your risk appetite. So that was my analysis of GSK. I hope you liked that. We will be moving on to Sanofi, but in the next video. I hope to see you in the next video. Bye.